Good morning, everyone, and welcome to CCO Hoxton Online, where we will share some worship and a word specially prepared for you all.
We meet here every Sunday at 10 a.m. and you can access the stream via social links on Facebook, Instagram or YouTube as CCL Hoxton or as CCL Newman.
Alternatively, you can watch today's message through the CCL website called cclnewma.org, where you can also give your tithes and offerings.
Please feel free to share this link with your friends or family, or just with someone that really needs to listen to this amazing message that will change their lives.
We currently run Saturdays Bible study and weekdays home groups, where you get a chance to share God's word in our community. So if you're interested and want to get involved, then feel free to reach out to us through our social media platforms.
As you're watching us, please don't forget to share your experience of church at home by tagging us using hashtag CCL at home. We look forward to share this time with you, and we pray that God speaks to you in this Sunday morning. Please don't forget to take notes of the preaching. God bless you and enjoy the service.
Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Roaring like a lion. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
The battle belongs to you, Lord. This is the year to shine, and we know that God will do great things in our lives. Thank you for connecting to our online service. These are this week's announcements.
Now we have a better way of donating. Simply go to cclnewmer.org and click donate. Enter the amount you would like to give, fill in the form, select the campus you belong to. If you are a UK taxpayer and you would like to gift aid your donation, please tick the box. Press give now, fill in your card details and press the blue button. We give a huge thanks to each one of you for your donation during these times.
We're beginning our new term for School of Discipleship. If you want more information and you want to study with us, please send us a message.
Don't forget that our online groups are running throughout the week. If you'd like to be part of one of the groups, send us a message and we will put you in contact with one of them. It is important to maintain connected during these times.
Join us every Saturday for our Bible studies. We will be studying the book of Romans, 10 a.m. every Saturday. For more information, you can send us a message on our social media.
For us, it's a pleasure to have you here. We hope you enjoy the service.
Welcome, everybody, to our online service. Thank you for joining us today for a very special service. Today's a special day. It's Father's Day. And so we wanted to do something different for everyone who is joining us online. We want you to experience here personally from different individuals that we have in our campus that are now fathers, new fathers. Some of them have been fathers now for many years. But we want you to hear their hearts, their experiences, have a conversation about their lives as being parents, fathers. And we want to just lift and celebrate all the fathers in this day. So if you're a father, we celebrate you today. We thank you for connecting. We pray that God continue to use you as that father and that man of God to lift up that house that he's given you. So today we welcome you all. And so now, just before we start, I just want to say, I remember personally when my wife was about to give birth. How many fathers... when the early mornings of the morning, it could be early hours or it could be late at night, you know, it's morning, it's early morning. And I remember my wife, Maribel, she's starting to breathe deep. She's having deep breaths and she's starting to feel pains. And those pains are getting bigger and bigger throughout the night into the morning. And the next step is we evacuate straight to the hospital, rushing. And the reality hits us. A baby is about to come, you know, where she is mixed with all emotions. And I can just see her looking at me with mixed emotions saying, this is all your fault. And here's me thinking to myself, yes, it is. And I'm just thinking, Lord, I'm about to be a father. I'm about to be entrusted a small human being into my hands, into my life. And I'm thinking, am I even ready? This life has been growing almost 9 months in her, in darkness, and is about to come out and see the light, right? That alone is a gospel message there. And I'm thinking, wow, few hours later, cries start happening. How many of you remember that? The cries. The relief of life is through crying. Not from you crying, but from the baby crying in that moment. And so we hear the sounds of cries, and that's the moment we know new life has come. New life has happened. And I can just believe, just remembering that moment, and I'm thinking, Jesus, this little human being, this little life is in my hands now that you've brought to my life to become a father, a parent. So today I want to speak about those fathers, how that experience has been, how it's changed. Maybe each one of you have had a different experience in fatherhood and parents, but I know all of the experiences that we're going to hear today can some way, one way or another, relate to us and help us to grow in the knowledge that Christ is also our Father in heaven, a Father that maybe we don't see physically, but we learn through the scriptures and we learn through faith that he is still the same yesterday, today, and forever, and still working in each one of us. So today, guys, I've asked some of our guys to share some of our leaders and friends from the campus and family that are involved in our churches. So I've got them there with me online. They're connected with me now. And we're going to speak to them. I'm really thankful for them sharing with us. There's a verse I want to start with before I get the first speaker on. And so there's a verse in Proverbs 22. It's a very, very key verse. It says, train your child in the way of the Lord, and when he is older, he will not depart from it. Train up your child in the way that some other versions say the way he should go, so that when he is older, he will not depart from it. So I just love that verse because it gives us clear instruction, wisdom from God about us as parents to train. So the first person I want to speak to is Dario. Dario is originally from Ecuador. He's married Dorelli, who's from Colombia, and they have two beautiful boys. He is now serving the church, helps us in ministry, and he's online right now. And I don't want to ask Dario, how are you doing, Dario? You good?
Yes, thank you, David. Thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here with you guys celebrating this fantastic day of Father's Day all together. And really amazing to be here. Thank you for the invitation. Yeah, I'm really happy to share my, I will probably say short experience because I've just been with my boys 10 years. But in those 10 years, I have learned a lot.
I imagine. 10 years, wow. So what's the ages?
The age
what's
of
the ages
my,
of your boys?
Jacob is 8 and Milan is 10. He's just turned 10. 10 years okay. old.
So what's probably the question I have for you is, what's been the most challenging part of being a father of two boys? And how's your faith impacted on being a father today?
Yeah, literally, it is a challenge because everything, to be completely honest, was new to me. Even the relationship between boys, because I've been surrounded by women, by ladies my whole life. I have my mom. I don't have any brothers. I have my younger sister, my older sister, and obviously my dad is been with us always. But my dad was always, you know, the man of the house, the traditional Latino, living in the morning, coming back in the evening. So I had to spend a lot of time with girls. And as you said it, for me, it was a completely new experience of how to manage the relationship between boys. Because with my sisters was some sort of like soft situation, you know, and the boy of the house, the baby of the house. And I was a bit of untouchable, but my sisters were like fighting all the time. And when I come into my house, the environment is completely different. I have two boys fighting each other, like arguing each other, because another thing is that they're very close age. One is 8 and the other one is 10. So they literally kind of at like the same level. So I have to always negotiate. I have to always probably sit down with them and manage the relationship differently. So it's been new to me. Moving on with the situation of being father in Christ, being father in what we know as a Christianity, or some other people probably relate to like religion. So why is it being a father in Christ? Is also, again, a completely new experience to me. My dad, my mom, my family, the very strong Catholic background. So they, to give you another a bit of a context, just before we leave in Ecuador to travel to emigrate to London, they say like, we have to baptize Dario, we have to baptize Dario. And you know, traditionally, when you see the pictures, they baptize you as a baby, you know, like 6 months, 1 year old. My picture is 12-year-old. They baptized me at age of 12. So I'm kind of like big boy baby having my baptism in traditionally in Ecuador. So for those Latinos backgrounds, maybe they understand that it's a bit of shame.
All dressed in white.
Yeah, all dressed in white. But they say like, if anything happens in the plane or anything happens as we migrate to another country, at least you're going to go to heaven because we managed to baptize you at 12-year-old. So I say like, all right, then let's do it. All those things have been broken, have been obviously, I would say, like reprogramming my mind and in myself as we get to know Christ. And those are the things that probably are challenging right now That is what I'm trying to introduce my kids, trying to have conversations with them. Obviously, now we're facing new challenges with new things coming up, you know, all the things that the kids are being teach at school right now. So it's a situation that me and my wife, we're trying to balance the situation. But in Christ, everything, I think the bottom line is that we always take it to the Bible. We always take it to what God says about this. That is the difference. I never had a relationship with my dad when he said, like, this is what God thinks. This is what the Bible teaches. It's always about this is how it's done, and this is how it's always been done, and this is the tradition that your granddad used to do, so we're going to continue doing it this way. And that's been kind of like the experience and the situation with being a father in Christ. And the last thing I want to touch is like, what is my aim and what is my probably focus being a father for my boys and obviously for everybody in my house, is that my ultimate goal is trying to create a home which becomes a refuge for my kids. That anything that they happen outside, they can run home, walk through the door, and feel that they are in a refuge, they are in a cave, that nobody is, nothing is going to happen to them. We as fathers, we as humans make a lot of mistakes. I had to put my hands up. I'm not a perfect father. I have made so many mistakes, and some mistakes that sometimes are sometimes difficult to deal with, but you have to carry on. And why do I want to create this? What I want to focus on creating some sort of like refuge and an escape place where you're facing everything outside. You can be facing bullying, you can be facing competition, you can be facing pressure, you can be facing temptation, but as know that if you run home, you know that this place is not a place of judgment, it's not a place of condemnation, it's a refuge. Why do I have this feeling in my heart is because my parents, being Christian or Catholic, whatever, they managed to do that with me. When I arrived to this country, it was challenging to go to secondary school, face new culture, face a new school without knowing English. And my only refuge was like 4:30, run home. You know, finish secondary school, year 9, year 10. My refuge was like, get a bus, go home. And as soon as you cross that door, everything is going to be okay. So that is what I try to create in the long term. Hopefully for my boys. I know the boys, I know they're more active. And if I remember myself when I was young, I also used to like hang around a lot when I was young. But as I say to you, I had always in my mind a place to come back. And that is what I probably aim. And I hope God help me out to always create that environment. As I say to you, we're not perfect, but in Christ, I know that we're trying as much as we can with his guidance to be the father that he wants us to be.
That's really good, Dario. Thank you so much. Really, really good, insightful. Creating that place of refuge, creating that place for them to return. Really nice. Really nice. Next, I'd like to speak to James. James is probably the newest in our campus from our group here. Also, probably the newest dad in our group here. And he's got two lovely daughters. I think he's going to have a team of girls coming, and God is dealing with you. And for some reason, he's giving you these girls for a reason. I think there's got to be a plan there. But please do share with us how's it been for you now being a dad to two lovely girls, and how's things been for you growing up as well? How things have changed, and how walking in this Christian faith now, have you learned now to implement what you've received and what you've been learning in the community to apply now as a father? Please do share.
You know, Pastor David, that is a great question and expertly asked as always. I think I can't really speak about how I am as a father without actually speaking about my own father, my own dad. And I looked up to him as a hero, and he was indeed my hero. He always seemed to have the right words. He always seemed to know where to find the things that I needed. And whenever it came to advice, I always found that he was second to none. So he had set this incredibly high bar, and the benchmark and the watermark was so high. And so when I got the news of the birth of my first daughter, Hannah, or that rather my wife was pregnant, I immediately panicked in a sense. You know, you this feeling of great joy, but also of intense panic. In the beginning, you feel as though 9 months gives you a lot of time. You've got so much time to prepare. It's 9 months away. And as the weeks go by, as you go past the first scan, the second scan, you know, you start to think, oh my gosh, my heart is beating inside my chest. The baby's going to be here soon. I haven't painted the room. I haven't, you know, prepared for this. I don't have a stroller. All these various things go through your mind. And I always used to think about the cool, collected way my father would always sort of give out this advice in nice round tones. And I wondered how he could be so calm in situations of quite immense panic and commotion. So I tried to look up to him and channel him. But I also remember the mistakes that he made. And I remember a little while before my before the birth of my first daughter, Hannah, I got down on my knees and I prayed at my bed. And I asked the original father, my father in heaven, how it is that I could rise to this challenge. And the, you know, what I received in that moment of communion with God was that we don't necessarily rise to any challenge, but we fall back to our highest level of preparation. And so that's exactly what we started to do. We started to prepare to understand the fact that I will make mistakes, but it's okay, because from those mistakes, we're able to journey through. We can move forward, and with the help of God, with the help of everyone around us, we can rise up and overcome these various challenges that often, you know, obstruct our path. I think my biggest concern as becoming a father was that I wasn't good enough, that I just couldn't meet the challenge. And I soon discovered that I was my own obstacle in that respect. And I needed to get out of my own way and allow God to work within me to be the father that he knows I should be and that I can be. And it's not about giving your children or even my girls everything that they should wish for or want. It's about giving them what they need, most of all, meeting the needs of the heart and the pleas of the soul. And for me, that the thing that I want to do most, and I think the thing that most fathers yearn towards, is they want to protect. They want to protect their children from everything that is out there in the world that may pose any sort of harm. And I know that I knew that I couldn't do that. I couldn't be there at every single moment. I couldn't protect them from any terrible thing ever happening to them. So what I decided on as a new father is that I would strengthen them from within. I would create for them a fortress, a high tower from within, where they could withstand anything that the world had to throw at them, so that they could be confident to speak to me about anything, so that they could reach out and support others, so that they could be understanding, and so that they could think critically. And in my own way, that is the embodiment of what I think makes an impactful father. Not the best father, not the one who'll win, you know, dad of the universe or father of the year, but one who is there for his children, who can stand up and say that I may not be able to do everything that's beyond me. I would love to make promises to my girls that I will be there in every major life event that they have. But these are not promises I can make. So it's having the courage to understand your own limitations, both as a man and as a father, and being able to say that despite these limitations, I will strengthen you so that you can go beyond where I ever could go. So I'm certain that I'm raising a wonderful set of girls, and they will become phenomenal women. And it is my hope that they surpass me in every sense of the word, that they surpass me, and that they go far beyond anything that I've ever accomplished, and both in their, you know, personal lives and in anything that they encounter. And I think that the benchmark now for me as to how I see my work as a father is their closeness to the Lord, their ability to retain and maintain meaningful relationships, to be good friends, to support their community, and to have a sense of belonging, both in the world and not of this world, with the Father in heaven. And it is my hope that I can be his representation here on earth, that I can reflect to a certain degree the awesome greatness and the amazing moments that I've seen in my own life. And hopefully to a small part, I can give them some of the cherished experiences that I've had when I was growing up, the way I looked up to my father. And so it is my sincere hope that one day they can look back and say to a small degree that I too was their hero. I think you're on mute, Christian. Sorry, I think you're on mute, David.
Yeah, amazing, amazing. Stood out, really good, thank you. Preparation is a key word that you mentioned, being a role model and knowing that you won't always be, obviously you can't promise them everything. You can't promise them the world, because it's true, it's unrealistic, you know, you can't. But I love your honesty and your desire to be that dad that's gonna be always available, always confident in to trust you and to build that.
Absolutely, and I think the last thing that I would wish to say is that it's not possible to do it alone. As fathers, we require a group of men to stand beside, to confide with, to also share this journey of fatherhood. I'm in the early steps of my journey. My eldest is 2 years old, about to become 3 years old, and so it is to look at other fathers like Dario, like Alvaro, and others to show the way and to show the path and to learn from, to glean that understanding and to get further understanding. As well, Pastor David, you're further ahead in your journey. And we often look at one another and what we're doing, not as a comparator, but to see, how else can I provide a degree of support? We all support our children in different ways, but it's good to be able to also glean over to the father beside you on each side and say, what can I learn from this father? Mm-hmm. How can I improve as well what I'm doing, and reflect that in the way that God wishes me to in my own household, and to help those around me, and also to be a father to those in the community who may not have one.
That's it. Amazing. That's it. Amen. Really good. Thank you, James, for sharing. Thank you so much. I'd like to also invite Christian, who's one of our leaders at the campus, and I've known him since he was single. I knew him when he was in his courtship, and then I knew him when he had his kids, and probably going to know him when he has his grandchildren. So we've seen each other throughout all the years, and it's an honor to call him a friend. I'm just so pleased that he can share his experience with such confidence, because what God has done in his life. And we're going to hear a little bit about him, because I think some of you don't know much about his upbringing. Some of you may know his sister, his brothers, his siblings, but maybe obviously you see him with his son and a daughter. He has a child, he has a girl and a boy. They're both still young, and he has a pet dog now. So like, there's more to the family. But I've asked him this question. So like, what have you learned throughout this process? Obviously being now a father and learning from what happened growing up for you, and just share a little bit about that. What has God done, and what's the process? What has God done to get you where you are today? And let people know here today. So thank you, Chris, for sharing.
Right. Well, thank you, David, for inviting me today. I mean, it's a privilege, sharing and learning and hearing all the good things that fathers do. And today is a special day, Father's Day, and it shouldn't just be one day. We should celebrate more, because I think there was a generation where there was no one to look up to. They call it fatherless generation. And I think even that God is changing. God is changing the generation. And now you can see along, and there's very good fathers out there. So for me, to be honest, I wasn't like Darius. It was very different, or like James as well, because in my case, my personal case, my father was never around. And it wasn't that he passed away or anything like that. I think he was always there. I know he was there somewhere in Ecuador, running around from town to town. And it wasn't just because he was working. No, you know, he was doing, he was one of those guys that, you know, would like to play a lot with women, you know, and it was just, and for me, it was quite difficult to see a father figure, you know, to relate to any father or wish to be a father. There was a point in my life where I even thought, you know, what's the point of being married? You know, because, you know, you can do anything without being married. What's the point of a family even? Because I wasn't, when I grew up, there wasn't that father figure. There was no one there. So I had to sort of learn things that a father should have taught their kids by myself. And so when I go to church, you know, that area in my life needed to be renewed. My mindset needed to change. And I began to see what fathers are like, when I began to see how life should be. And in my mindset was, it was that was normal. But when I came to church, when I came to know Christ, I suddenly began to think that, you know, actually what I was thought was correct or was normal, it wasn't. So as you know, I got married at church, and we decided, you know, we're going to have kids. We pray, and God gave us a word. So we decided, okay, let's go for the first one. Initially, we said we're going to have 4 kids. You know, because you do have that conversation with your wife, like, how many kids are you going to think you're going to have? So 4 kids, 4, not knowing what involves, not knowing what actually entails to have kids. So I said, oh, we have 4. But we had the first one, and I was like, you know what, that's it, man. I'm not having any more kids. Because it's very demanding. And for me, it was new. As many of you have already said, you do make mistakes. You do say, you know, you sort of learn along the way. But for me, it was even harder because, as I said, I never grew up with a father. I didn't know what a father should do. I didn't know what a father should say, the right words, how to direct them. So I always had to start looking somewhere else. And coming to Christ, I needed to learn, you know, from God as well, you know, knowing what a father was, and learning in the Bible what means to be a father. It for me was really a struggle at the beginning. But thank God, you know, we have him. I don't know what I would do if I didn't have God in my life, because he did sort of gave with patience, with love, taught me what I should do, what I shouldn't do. You know, and again, you know, being in a community with growing up with a community, as you David said, you know, we grew up together. We sort of, I think our kids are also more or less the same age as well. So with Dario's kids as well. My daughter, she's 10. My son is 8. My baby dog is only 9 months. and my turtles, I think, is a few months as well. So, but I think our kids also grow together. And I think that's one of the blessings as well. So I think God is great. God is amazing. He's been teaching me a lot throughout the whole. One of the things I do trying to transfer to my kids, it's about values and principles that I have learned through the Bible, and such as integrity, honesty, you know, faithfulness, and all these things, because for me, these are the things that are going to be taken with them. I said to them, you know, I'm not going to be around you all of your life. There will be a time where I will go to heaven. I'll meet, and then you're going to have to be there by yourselves. So for me, one of my goals is to teach them to be independent and individually seek God, independently also seek and fall in love with God, because I don't want them to be pressurized to know Christ, or because I told them, because this is the right thing, because obviously it's Christian's God. Or no, I want them to fall in love the same way as I did, you know, by myself, and, you know, going into the Lord, that's what I want them to do. So for me, that's my aim, and that's what I'm doing as well, as well as Dario. For me, having peace in my home is the most important thing in my house. I grew up with a family, my father will start screaming, my mother will start screaming, they will hit each other physically. I went a vivid image in my mind where I saw my father, you know, physically punching my mom, and I didn't want that for my house. So, you know, in my house, even raising your voice, you know, that's not right. Screaming at each other, that's not right. And they know this. And that's the sort of things are trying to put in my household at the moment, those sort of principles, values as well. Also the ability, because something I did learn is that it's okay for them to see that the father is not perfect. Because initially I thought, oh, I gotta be the dad that they want to look up to. I want them to see the hero. But a hero doesn't mean you're perfect. You know, person that you know you, for them to look after doesn't mean they're perfect or they tick all the boxes. But they do need to be able to see that yes, he is also a human being that does make mistakes, but with the difference that when he does, he has the courage to accept them, to put their hand up, and also to admit it, and then you say, oh, let's rectify it. And that's the sort of things I do teach to my kids as well. And also, one of the things I do work really hard is to live my life in such a way that they don't have to look up the Bible. They see the Bible in me. Like example. For example, I don't want them to go to church or go to cell group because I tell them. I want them to see that it is so natural in us. I don't want them to be looking out for God or seeking for God because they've been told to do, but I don't want them to be growing inside of them. So for me, example is the great thing. And the one thing I do commit to, I have committed to them, is to love their mother, my wife. Because, you know, I read in the book as well, you know, if you want your kids to have good marriage as well, they need to be able to see what it is to love your wife. If you respect your wife, if you love your wife, if you support your wife, the kids will see it. And it's not point you telling your kids, oh, you know, we, you know, God loves you or whatever. But if they see that you shout, you scream at your mother, you disrespect your wife, their mother, then they're not going to take you seriously. They think, you know what, this guy is not for real. And for me, it's been challenging and heartfelt and, you know, confrontational at times, but it's been very rewarding because now I see my kids growing and you're thinking, God, I would not have been able to do it without you. And I'm still learning. I mean, you know, they grow and they're going to the teenagers now. So I've tried myself to learn a lot more, you know, try to learn from everyone, trying to learn from books, but, yeah, I mean, I'm looking close to those teenage now, and I'm trying to put as much as possible the principle, the values right from the beginning. So when they grow, they will be ready to choose by themselves the right decisions because they know. I said to them, look, listen, I'm not going to be around. You're going to have to decide what's right or wrong. And for me, that's basically what it is. And, you know, it's amazing, though. It's amazing. Life is not the same. It's changed. Your kids change your life drastically, massively, but for the good, because the memories they do, the things they do, and the one thing I do also try to do is spend time with them, dedicate some quality time with them, because as you know, they will grow and they will not be there with you all the time. They will leave your there and they will go for the husband, the wives, and then, you know, so you need to make sure you make most of the time that they are with you right now. So there. I don't know what else to say.
Really good. That's been really, really good. There's some really, really good points there, some really good examples of what you've established in your home. And it's really amazing. It's really, really good. Those are the things that we can take on board and we can learn from those experiences. And it's amazing. It doesn't matter how you started. It's about how you finish, right? It's about how you are now running this race. And so that's really good to hear what you have said in your home. You know, you didn't see it in your home when you were growing up, but you said, I'm going to establish this in my home. And you've put that as a principle, and it's very good. Last guy, it's Alvaro, one of our also another team leaders here in our church campus. Alvaro has been also a guy I've seen grow up in the church from single. I've seen him get married as well, and he's got kids. But his case is a little bit different. When he got married, he became a father straight away because the wife that he married, the woman that he married, she came with a child. And so his case was different. He had to step straight into fatherhood. But this has been amazing because this for him has been an experience and it hasn't stopped him from serving the Lord, hasn't stopped him from growing and being that man of God. So I wanted you to share an example on how did that go about and how was that for you? You know, and share a little bit quickly how that experience was and what did you implement in your Christian faith to help you with this child that came into your marriage, into your family, into this home that you were building now. Alvaro, go ahead.
Thank you, Pastor Davey, for the opportunity to invite me to share my testimony with my kids. And I'm already been learning a lot from James, Dario, and Christian, and of course from Pastor David. For me, it's been like a journey. And as James says, being the man who I am now, and especially with my kids, is because of my dad. My dad is he's a really big figure in my life, and his voice speaks louder in me. And I believe so. I never forget when I wanted to get married, Nancy. Nancy came to Colombia, so he has a chat with Nancy, and they talking, and I knew it that my dad is the type of person that if he likes you, he likes. If he don't, he just say hello and don't talk no more. But with Nancy was different. But I remember it was Monday when he says to me, and he called me, says, okay, so you're gonna get married, Nancy? I say, yes, Dad. So I say my testimony about how I fell in love. So he says, so is that good? But he says, he asked me, but have you noticed that she have a daughter? I say, yeah. And it's good. So, but he says something that actually I never thought, and he actually marked my heart, because he says to me, that is your daughter already, and you need to consider from now on as your daughter, because if you don't, when she grow up, you're not going to see her as a daughter. You're going to see like a woman, and it's going to bring your problem into your life. So he actually, that marked my heart. And since that day, even I know, Nicole has his dad, but that day I took like the ownership to be her dad. I took the position that she's my real daughter. And since that day I decided, and even I know sometimes when they go in the age of teenage, when you say something that they don't like it, they're trying to, to talk back to you in the wrong manner. But I ask God, because that's why is where Christianity comes. I believe is where God comes to give you a wisdom, how to manage each situation. Because in my case, I have three kids, but all of them, they are quite different. They are totally different. It's like you cannot treat one, the other, let's say you cannot correct one in the same way to correct the other one. Because one you can talk, the other one maybe is with the barita. But yeah, it's like it's been an amazing, and I believe so. The church also helped me quite a lot to be the man who I am, and the husband who I am, the dad who I am. But the most important thing I believe so is, as Christian says, I think the goal as a dad is to teach my kids to take a decision. Even if they take the wrong decisions, to face it, because that is character, to face it, to recognize that, I made a mistake, but to lift up and keep going. That's, I believe so, as a dad, that's my goal, because that's, I believe so, is what my dad teach me, and also my mom, is to face the problems, never run from the problems. You need to face it. And I believe so, that's gonna help quite a lot in a character for a boy, for a girl. That's the most important thing. And in my case, I have a daughter of 19 years old, 10 years old, and 9 years old. So when I see them, each of them, they need a different treatment. It's like, I know the love of my oldest daughter, Nicole. She likes quality time, and quality time is not like is quality time. Like I say, we're gonna have a coffee, so we're gonna have a conversation. So I have to listen what she has to say, and sometimes I have to be quiet. I love to talk, so I like to, when somebody sends me something, I would like to, I like to interrupt. But with her, I have to listen and wait until she asks me what I'm thinking. So I have to learn on that. Sarah is different. Sarah loves gifts. So if he, it's about gifts and those stuff. But Isa is also quality time. So I have to play with him. So I have to make an effort to play a match, to go and see the match, to give a report how was the match. So they treat different, but thanks God, and also my wife has been helping me quite a lot, because she says to me, Albert, I think you need to pass time with Sarah, you need to pass time with Isaac, you need to ask things about this. And it's been a journey. And I believe so. I never was prepared to be a dad. As James says, I was terrified when to take the responsibility, because I say, you know, I say, I'm so imperfect, so how I'm gonna guide and somebody else. But yeah, it's been a journey. It's been amazing. But the most important thing is, like, I would love to honor my dad in this, especially this Sunday, because it's amazing the how God used his life. Even he is not Christian, or he's a Christian. He already accepted Christ, but he didn't read the Bible. But I believe so. There is certain things God put in his heart, like that, to be honest, to speak truth, because he loves to and confront issues. He's the guy who confront issues, and he teach me from a very young age to confront the issues, to not to hurt, you know, not to harm people, but to confront. And especially as I think Dario was saying, I also grew up just with girls. It was my mom and two girls. And I remember he used to say to me constantly, you are a man, you need to behave as a man. Since I think I was 3 years old, because you know, you play with your sister and things. And I remember, you know, but he always marked my identity as a man. He says to me, you are a man. And I have a boy. And I remember I always say to him, since he's again in the morning, say, Isa, you are a man. You should behave as a man. Man has to behave this way. And I always, you know, constantly I say those things to my dad, says to me, because I believe so. You know, it helps me so much in my life. So yeah, as a Christian says also, you know, the goal is to transmit them the principles, God's principles, values, that also it comes in a family, because also, you know, family has a value that's mm-hmm. quite important. In my way, it's quite so important. Like my dad always says to me, you know, a united family can build an empire. So I believe so. It's quite important to be united. And united doesn't mean we have to think the same way. Is like to have a conversation and get an agreement. Yeah. So I think that's any other questions?
No, that's really good. Really good. I think we've gone over our time, but it's been really good. It's been really insightful. So much to take in, so many key points that we can learn from it. Just to kind of conclude all this conversation, we read Proverbs 22:6 at the beginning, right? Where it says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. The key word here is train. It's like God saying to us, we're like trainers, maybe like a personal trainer, you can think of like that, or someone who trains someone, a mentor, someone who's preparing someone for a role, for a career. In the same way, we've been given that responsibility to be trainers for those children. And it's really important. And I was looking at that word train up, and in the translation in Hebrew, it says chanak. And chanak actually means to initiate or to dedicate. So it's like we have to dedicate, or in first instance, like give our child to God, or to nurse, or to teach, or to discipline him as God's child, who we've been entrusted in his care. And I just thought, that's so powerful. God puts that in us to train. There is a responsibility. It's not something to avoid. It's not something to pass on to the spouse or to our spouses. It's something that we take on together. But as a father, there's many key things we should have to do. One of the things that Albert was saying is mark their identity. I love Christian. He said, put in them established principles and values. You know, James, you mentioned about creating a place of preparation, and that's very important. And also, and Dario talking about place of refuge. When I think of a place of refuge, I think of like the prodigal son. When Jesus was sharing that story of Luke, yeah, about the prodigal son, it was a story, remember, but he was emphasizing what it is the father. He was talking about how the father's heart is. It wasn't about, I'm waiting for my son to come back, who's gone away, who's messed up, or doing, you know, who's spending his money, to discipline him or to get angry at him, but I want to love him. I want to receive him. I want him to come back home. And I think this is what we're called to do, to build a home. Something of our church, we want to, what we have as a slogan is a home for all. We believe in the home. We believe God believes in the home. We believe Jesus died for the home. And that reason, that's why we do what we do here, community. That's what James was saying, is doing this life alone is hard. We need people around us. Each one of us in our journey from being single or young, whatever stage, we've had people around us to teach us in our faith. Maybe you've had people around you in your professions, in your careers, in your education, but we need also people around us to build us in our faith, to make us grow. I love my dad. Right now, my dad is someone who is now serving the Lord alone because my mother passed away. But every time I share with my dad, he gives me wisdom. He challenges me in my thinking. He makes me think bigger in my faith. He makes me see things in a different view because of his knowledge of the word. And yet he still shows me his loving, caring fatherhood. There's sometimes he doesn't want to just preach to me. Sometimes he just says, Dave, just sit here and watch the football with me. And just that alone brings comfort, brings strength to my soul because it's just spending time with him. Spending time with people of faith helps us to also grow together. So I love all these things that we've talked about today. I think it's very important as parents that as we've been speaking, we have a great responsibility to be models and examples. Because if I, like Christian was saying, if my children see the way I treat my wife, but if their children also see the way I think about prayer, about church, then that's the way they're going to think about it. If church is important to me or prayer life is important to me, it's going to be important to them. If it's not important to me, then why should it be important to them? The truth is this, we have a big responsibility to not just educate them and give them knowledge, but to give them the foundation of Jesus, to give them the truth about Jesus, that he died on the cross for our sins, and that whoever called upon his name and receives him can be born again and have eternal life. That is the free gift of grace that we share. The reason we are all here being fathers and learning and growing together is because one day we made a decision to accept Jesus in our heart and say, you know what, Lord, I'm going to receive you. I'm going to believe that you are the living God and that you died on the cross for my sins. I don't know where you are listening right now. If you're a father, you're a new father, you're in a relationship, you're a single parent. I also want to honor you. I want you to know that you are not alone and that Jesus loves you and that he is ready to show you that he is not just God as the sovereign God, as maybe we've learned in religion or growing up, but that he is a father. He is a father to all who receive him, and he allows us to call us sons. So that's, and he wants to receive you. So today I want to invite you, if you're listening for the first time, to receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Maybe you've never done that, or maybe you've been far away from God. And now in these challenging times, you've realized, Lord, I need you in my marriage. I need you in my parenting. I need your help because I've tried to do it on my own. And I sometimes think I'm replicating what I saw when I was growing up. The truth is, when you come to Christ, the Bible says that all things are made new. The old has gone, the new has come. You can become a new creation. You can start again, new, with a clean slate, putting aside, knowing that Jesus has forgiven you of all your sins, that you do not hold on to what maybe you grew up with. You are not a replica of maybe abuse, of an upbringing of hurt and pain. You do not need to bring that into your future. You can leave that at the feet of the cross and allow Jesus to do something new in your heart, if you allow him. If you allow me, I would love for you to pray. And along with the other fathers here, we're going to pray. And we want to invite you to do a prayer of faith. And just do this prayer with us today and just say this. Just bow your heads and close your eyes and just say, Lord Jesus, I thank you for today and for listening to these testimonies. I love that the word testimony means test. People that have gone through tests and today can speak boldly, confident that you got them through it, that they've had faith to make and see that you are good and faithful. Today, Lord Jesus, I want to receive you in my heart. Forgive me of all my sins. Forgive me maybe for the mistakes I've made with my children, with my spouse. And today, make me that father you called me to be, that man of God. I pray, Lord Jesus, because this is a time that we need to rise up more than ever, to not just for our families, but for those around us. There's many people that are looking for Jesus, and many times they can see it in the lives of others. Allow us, Lord, to be those examples. So I pray, I receive you as my Lord and Savior, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you for praying, and thank you for joining us. If you're new, please do connect with us. Send us a message on the chat. Tell us you just received did this prayer for the first time, and you'd like to know more about us. We are on social media, on Facebook, on Instagram. Our services are now physical. You can come and join us. You can register online and just meet us in person, and we would love to meet you. We are a home for all, but we're also a church online, which we now call a hybrid church. So we're available for you guys online and in physical. Guys, I hope you've enjoyed the service. Have a great Sunday. Happy Fathers to all of you. We celebrate you. And thank you guys for doing this today. It's been amazing. God bless you all, guys. All right, see ya.